the intermediary spirits of the universe, and as well as our Ogun, or bloodline ancestors within our racial ancestors, which are the larger Ogun. So I will start by invoking the presence of the great supreme deity, supreme consciousness, known by many names, Inyame, Amin Ra, Chukwu, Olofin, Olodumare, Jehovah God, Allah, and whatever name you choose to refer to the great divine, masculine and feminine principle of the universe, we say Ashe.
Ashe.
Next, now we want to call on those spiritual forces that God created to help man and woman realize your God consciousness here on earth. We'll start with the Great Mother, as known in the religion of Ifa of the Yorubas of West Africa, Yemoja. We say Ashe.
Ashe.
Her divine number is 7. Her colors is blue and white, closely related to Yemoja. We want to call on that force known as Olokun. Ashe. Olokun is that masculine energy of the deep, dark water. He's the father of the unconscious. His number is also 7. It's said that Yemoja and Olokun work together. Next, we call on Yemoja's younger sister. Her name is Oshun. Ashe. Her divine number is 5. Her colors are the colors of honey, gold, and brown. She's the energy of the rivers, the lakes, and the streams, responsible for childbirth, responsible for physical attraction, sexual attraction, presence, and the aura that we carry around with us. Next, we call on the great feminine force of the wind. Her name is Oya Ashe. Oya brings the change. She guards the cemeteries. She's the queen of the marketplace. Her number is 9. She wears a skirt of 9 colors, symbolizing death, but not death in a -6, but death in a +6. And because from death comes reincarnation and regeneration. Ashe. Next, we call on that divine aspect of metal, of war. His colors are green and black. His number is 3. He's known as the god Ogun. Ashe. Ogun is that energy called on. We need some energy to perk us up. We're coming up with a new invention. We need a new car. We gotta take an airplane flight. We wanna make sure that plane gets safely where it's gonna go. We call on Ogun. Next, we call on Ogun's brother, Ochozi. Ashe. Ochozi is the energy that helps us track our goals, track our spiritual progress. Indeed, next we want to call on Eshu Alekba, Ashe. Eshu is the youngest of the Orisha, one of the most powerful. His colors are black and red. His number is 3. He owns the keys to Ashe and the keys to all paths. And you can only communicate to any other Orisha by first communicating with Eshu Alekba, Ashe. And of course, we can call on Baba Lubaye. He's the energy of health and the energy of the disease. He can make you sick, he can also make you healthy. Ashe. And there's so many Orisha, so many Loa, so many Lexa, so many Abusa. We can never know them all, but we can feel them all. And we have the right, the divine right, to communicate with those Orisha to help us reach our spiritual goals. Ashe. Next, we want to call on our bloodline ancestors, those of your family who have went on and went to the next level, and now they up in the ancestral realm. So now I ask you to call some of the names of your living dead. Give me some of your nieces and nephews and grandparents, brothers and sisters and cousins who you have lost. Give me some names. Ashe, give me some more. Ashe, who do you call? Ashe, who do you call? Ashe, build up that power. Who do you call? Ashe, who do you call? Ashe, all right, now we want to go. Ashe, now we want to go to the Ogunzo. These are our collective African racial ancestors who you may not be related to. I start with Queen Mother Harriet Tubman. Ashe, who do you call? Ashe, who do you call? Ashe, Sojourner Truth, who do you call? Ashe, who do you call? Ashe, who do you call? Louis Flatterer, Ashe, who do you call?
Khalid Muhammad.
Ashe, who do you call?
Yeah,
exactly why. Hey, D, who do you call? Ashe, make sure you don't name no sellouts. Ashe, who do you call? Ashe, Ashe, Ashe. All right. Bless, 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 and blessings. And of course, in your home, you should all have an altar, an ancestral altar, a nice tree, plant, some fruit, white candles, some incense, a vessel of water, You should go to that altar every morning and invoke your ancestors to go to work with you, give them a car with you. They're there for you, but you don't use them. Stop calling those little naked angels that you was raised on in Sunday school. A little white boy with big penis is hanging out, supposed to come help you with wings on your back. Not true at all. Not true at all.
Welcome, Ashe, Ashe, Ashe. Welcome to Universally Speaking with Rahim Islam on 860 AM WNOV, The Voice. I am your co-host, Ptosha, with a P, Davis. I'm so happy to be here in the studio. We've got a full house in here today, and the man with the plan, our esteemed host. Just come on and go with me. Mr. Rahim Islam is in here with the studio, in the studio with us right now. How you doing, Rahim?
Hey, you know, I'm doing great. Thank you. It's good. Hey, look, I haven't been, you've been missing in action. You've been MIA, but you were here Friday, but I wasn't here. So it seemed like it's been a minute since you.
I was gone for over a week. Yeah.
Okay. So, well, glad you're back.
I'm glad I'm back.
So you're not missing in action.
I'm not missing action. Okay. And I didn't even listen this last week when I was gone. Well, okay, yes, I did a little bit. We also have in the studio with us today, Mr. Mark Wade. Mark, you have so many titles. I'm not even going to try to distinguish them all. We're just going to say he's from the community.
That's good enough.
And then we also have Bria Grant joining us in the studio today. How you
good
doing
afternoon.
Today, Bria?
Good afternoon.
So
Bria got her purple on. She told me that was royalty.
Purple represents
she thought
royalty.
She thought you knew already.
No, I didn't know. I was at the church yesterday and I was seeing all the sisters in purple, so I didn't know. I just thought somebody put out a memo.
You like, how come I didn't get it? Nobody tell
everybody
me.
I had purple on. It looked good, but you know, purple. You know,
actually, that used to be. Well, there is. You know, back purple used to be the most expensive dye that you could get, so that's what royalty wore.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. Well, see, hey, look, I'm learning all the time. That's great. That's great.
And, of course, we have the rest of our team. Mr. Tony Cash is always here in the background. If you ever see Rahim walking around and you wonder, is that the news following him?
I know I got my theme.
What's
my
going
theme,
on? His theme music.
Song, yeah.
That is actually... Our
reminds me of Blazing Saddles. You ever seen
Blazing? Yes. We don't want that type of thing.
Like by Gucci.
So that's actually Tony Cash, who, you know, when Rahim first brought this up, now it's been over 2 years since we've been doing this. We're capturing everything that's going on in this movement. So if you see that, it's not that he's starstruck or anything like that. He's actually capturing the movement of what's going on.
You know why I do this? See, let me tell you something. Because sitting with Kenny Gamble, and who's written and produced probably more hits than really anybody. I don't think there's a writing team greater than Gamble and Huff and the music. Nearly 150 albums, 60 artists, you know. I mean, just the unbelievable. And he didn't get none of it on tape.
Didn't they? Mm. Yeah.
You know, where the Beatles, they got everything. They got them jokers, you know, on everything aspect on tape, you know. And because it's just a matter of knowing and not knowing.
Right. Yeah.
And so, you know,
he... like documentation.
Yeah. And he used to say, jokers used to come around with cameras and get out of the studio. And so the bottom line is that he made all this history. And we got the albums and everything, the show for it, but no one knows how it actually happened, or, you know, you got to rely on the spoken word. So what I said, look, I believe we're going to make history, number one.
I believe in some aspects we already have.
Well, but we're just getting started.
We're just getting started.
And I think that, so if we can document it, we'll be able to show the next generation exactly what goes on, what does it take, and also hopefully they don't have to recreate something. So
right,
there's something tangible that they can you know, hand on hold. So
that's brilliant.
That was the whole reason for and
Tony came
having on. having my theme music behind me.
That's a brilliant idea though, because a lot of times you will find when people get to a place where they can come up with ideas and concepts and plans like you have, they will guaranteed treat that path or information like it's a secret recipe. Mm-hmm. They will keep it in their back pocket. They will want to share it with no one.
Mm-hmm. Well, I wish I could take credit, but listen to Kitty and listen to the little bit of like seeing the outtakes of some of the things with the OJs or Phyllis Hyman or, you know, some of the great Lou Rawls. And I mean, they have very little of it. And so hopefully we can demonstrate. First of all, we got to make history. And I think we're on our way. I think we're on our way to at least acknowledge that history needs to be made.
So I want to bring in another guest who's joining us via the phone. It would be Mr. Garland G. Smith. He is known as the Black Mayor of Milwaukee. How you doing, G?
I'm doing good, Ptosha. How about yourself? Hey, Rahim.
Hey, G. Hey, man, I was thinking about you today, man.
Hey, good brother.
How you doing?
How's it going?
Good, good.
So you guys are probably wondering why we have this illustrious panel just started. And don't be surprised if some more people drop in, because you know how we do it sometime in the studio. But Rahim, along with Gerald Jones, Mark Wade, G, people probably see his name and go, who is Garland Smith? That's G from G's Clippers. Also, Willie Hines, Melissa Goins, June Perry, Martha Love, and now the list is continuing to grow, are hosting a huge, huge event tomorrow. It is at 6 p.m. at Skybox Lounge on Martin Luther King Drive. And pick up a copy of the Milwaukee Courier.
Well, you said before, black-owned.
It is.
No, okay.
Well, it's on King Drive, so it's either one or two things owned. It's either black-owned or other.
Yeah, black-owned. No, we're proud of that.
And it is the launch for the Our Power, Our Future conduit. And if you don't know what that is, come out and find out what it's about. We're going to have some special guests. We're expecting a packed house. There won't be a line to get in. There's no cover charge at the door, but there is something that you need to commit to when you come in. And if you want to know what's going on, we're going to ask you to join us tomorrow at 6 p.m. at Skybox Lounge on MLK Drive, which is black owned. One of the owners is sitting here in the studio with us, and I think the other one is on the phone with us. But we are so excited to have the launch of the event take place at this particular venue tomorrow, November 17th. We're also going to have some special guests joining us. It'll be our four local alder persons, just these four particular for this event. We're going to have Alderman Willie Wade, Alderwoman Malele Cox, Alderman Ashante Hamilton, and Alderman Russell Stamper. And I want to say that I've spoken to all four of them today. So they are very excited.
Oh, good.
And the community is excited. If you want more information, you can go to ourpowerourfuture.com. You can RSVP, or you can also, there's an Our Power, Our Future page on Facebook. And you'll see this big circle that has some fists and some hands in it. And it's called Black Votes Matter. And so it's coming around that time when the election season is starting. You can see it in the news. You can see it. You haven't started hearing it on the radio quite yet, but the news a little bit. And pretty soon, after November, it's going to switch to TV ads and radio ads. And it's that time when politicians and those who aspire to be politicians are going to be asking for your vote. So we've been talking a lot about Black Lives Matter. And I shared a little bit on Friday from the most recent column Rahim wrote, Black Lives Will Only Matter When Black Votes Matter. And so I want to talk a little bit today about why that's so important. And, G, I want to thank you for calling in. I know you weren't able to make it, but I know you have been involved politically here in the city of Milwaukee with galvanizing and get out the votes and things like that. So what do you think about this event tomorrow?
I think it's very important, definitely needed. To my understanding, it's never been done. I mean, I've heard about it in other major cities, but to be able to help our politicians financially and be able to give our issues to them and hold them accountable and. I just think it's a great thing. I think that was one of the main things why a lot of our politicians don't get there, and that's being undercapitalized. What I'm speaking of is just not being elected. You know, just undercapitalized. And with this conduit, this will serve as a a major piece to that puzzle. And I'm extremely excited. I do know firsthand that that voting works. I was very intricate in the whole bill being passed with the separating the barber and cosmetology license. So I see firsthand that it definitely works. And I think more, as more African Americans see that their vote counts and it definitely works, I think you'll get more African Americans to vote. So I'm definitely excited.
Yeah, also she said you was the
unofficial black mayor. You didn't know that?
Well, no, he's the official black mayor.
Not yet. Well, we ain't elected him. We ain't got him in office yet.
No, but you said that for a reason. I think one of the things that we're going to talk about on tomorrow, kind of get a kind of preview of, is that we have to, and this is why when you said the Skybox, a black-owned business, in order for us to, we have to connect three dots. We have to connect our political activity with our business activity with our ability to organize and mobilize grassroots on the ground. So you add those three together, they represent our agenda. They also help us create a political voice. And so we're not going to get around the many of the challenges we face is because the anemic amount of black businesses that are in our community, black-owned businesses are in our community. And so we have to now up that level of participation, and we also have to have our political agenda aligned. And so if we can organize the grassroots to, you know, and the issues that they're pretty much simple. They're very simple. We need jobs. Well, guess what? We'll be waiting all day for other people to give us jobs. We got to create our own jobs. Well, we create our own jobs by creating or expanding and growing our business community. And so our politics and our politicians need to carry that message. So there's fundamentally one of the critical priority issues that we're going to be focusing on going forward is that if it's being delivered to black people, then black people need to be in front of it, you know. And so that's a paradigm shift right there. We're going to now hold our politicians to that principle. All politicians, black, white, green, purple, you name them. If you're delivering predominant amount of a delivery to black people, then it is black people that need to be in the front of that line, because it is our people, number one. And number two, we know best for our own people. We right. know what's best for our own people. No one knows what's best for us better than us. So, you know, as a business leader, and we got to change the paradigm as well, is that we got to look at our community and who are the leaders in our community. The first group that has to be recognized as the leaders in our community has to be the business community.
Right, the business owners.
So that's why she said you was the
mayor,
the unofficial mayor, because you're a businessman, you know. And okay. So, and not only you're a businessman, but you have taken your business and you've been a compassionate person in your business, and you deliver your business, and you also not only – you know, do good business, but you take that capital and you give it back to our community. So we get a couple more of you, like you working like that, then we can start to fix things. Until we get that, we just going to be spinning our wheels.
And, you know, I was going to say another reason why I just want to thank you, G, for, you know, spearheading this and taking a stand and being out front, because it says a lot that you reflect the community. You're a young African American man. You have a family.
Ain't that young?
You can't tell. So, but we need role models to be back into our community. And so you are what so many of the upcoming generation look to be like. You and Mark and Corey and, you know, your whole squad. You know, you guys really give a great example of what a black man is in Milwaukee, how to be a black businessman, how to, you know, come from wherever you come from, whatever your background, whatever your past was, is where you end up today. And I think you guys do a really, really great job. Your face, your name alone will bring the attention, this issue, meaning Black Votes Matter, it'll bring it to people that would otherwise have turned their ear, that would, you know, say, oh, you know, that's old man talking, you know, they always talking about going to vote and stuff like that. We ain't in slavery and stuff like that no more. Like, this is what our community sometimes has a response. You change that conversation and say, man, if G, Mark, they down for this? Okay, let's see what this really about. Maybe, you know, if that's how they keep they flow rolling, that's maybe what I need to start being a little more mindful or understanding of how that process works and see how it can work for my economics, because it does all turn into economics when you get at the grand scheme of things. So I thank you for your example in the community and your leadership in the Our Power, Our Future. I also want to say, Rahim.
I really thank you. I thank you for your kind words. But I think for what you've seen in us, and I say us, me, Mark, my brother Corey, my cousin Myron, is basically we all believe that to whom much is given, much is required. And I've basically been living that for the past 20 years. Geez, Clippers has been open. I believe that God did not bless me to be where I am today and be in front of as many people that I'm in front of and have the influence that I have to just sit on it. You know, there is a responsibility. So, and that's the reason why I'm part of this movement as well.
So, G, if you had to give a shout-out to everyone, because, you know, everybody knows G's. They know G, even if they don't come get their hair cut there, they still know G. What would you say to them about coming out to join us for tomorrow?
It's their duty. It's their duty. I ask everyone under the sound of my voice, you know, to make it their business. Anything that they can, any appointment that they can reschedule, do it, you know, because this event tomorrow is definitely an event that everyone needs to be at, you know, and not only be at personally, if they can just bring something in their hands as well, because it takes money at the end of the day. We have to put our money where our mouth is. You know, there's so many of us that complain about so many things that's going on in our community. But and I understand resources are slim in many households in the urban community. But if we can just try to dig deep, you know, because also in the urban community we spend more money on clothes, you know, and shoes more than in most communities out there. So if we can just try not to spend some money on some shoes, you know, this week or pants or shirt, and just give that money for the betterment of our community, it's definitely something that we should do, you know. So everyone on the sound of my voice, you can please make it your business to be at 2213 North MLK Drive, that's Skybox Sports Bar, on tomorrow evening at 6 o'clock. You can actually say that you were a part of this movement, you know, this movement that's going to do so much good in our city and our state.
Thank you, G. I tell you, man, it's awesome. And it's a blessing that you even have a Skybox and be able to even bring it there. The other thing I was thinking about when you was talking was you mentioned it, this is a fundraiser. And let it be very clear that one of the things that people, I know it's a number of catch-22s that we're kind of faced with, what comes first, the chicken or the egg. Well, unfortunately, many of the things we're dealing with today has already been, you know, established. So we got to catch up. We got a lot of catching up to do, and one of the catch-ups that we have to make is getting in front of how we elect our elected officials. Who elects them? You could best in book and believe that anybody who runs for office, it's a cost to do that.
Yes.
So the question got to be, well, where's those funds come from? So when you're sitting up here upset because this older person or this person moved left and you want them to go right, well. One, if there's no communication of what direction you want them to go in, you can't expect them to go any other direction except the direction that those who are supporting them to tell them to go in, to advise them to go in, or ask them to go in. Mm-hmm. And if we're not supporting them, then, you know, this is why we have to get in front of the situation. So right now we got four I think Dynamo, all the persons, and Willie Wade and Millie Coggs and Ashanti Hamilton and Russell Stamper, that in my brief tenure here has been working together as a group, and understanding the magnitude of their as a caucus. So that's really, really important to me, and I think that you'll see, I think God willing, you'll see going forward how we're going to leverage this group to do some things for us, for our agenda. And we all know what the agenda is, but we're going to make the agenda official.
So let's get some of the hard questions out of the way. Why these four?
Well, you know, I'm a punt that over to Bria, because Bria has been fielding a lot of questions, and I like the way she responds. So go ahead, Bria.
It's a good question, and I have gotten that question as we encourage people to support.
I'm sorry, Raheem. I'm sorry. Hey, Bria, if you can get closer to the mic, I'm sorry.
You better produce this show from Carl and G. I love it. Go ahead.
No, I'm sorry.
Thank you, G.
Thank you. Yes. A little to the. Usually I'm too loud. So, but the reason why these four is because we believe that they provide the visual that we want individuals to see as it relates to a collective effort from our electeds. You leverage your resources better when you work collaboratively. And Alderwoman Cox, Stamper, Hamilton, and Wade, I believe that they've demonstrated that at the city level. And the goal is to duplicate this group. Hopefully we can get our Black caucus on board. You know, unfortunately, it's taking a little longer than it should, but this is what we need. And not everybody that is in this group is supported by everybody.
Right.
And we understand that. But you can't expect what you haven't inspected. For instance, you give a requirement for people to meet, but you haven't given them the measurement. So this is that. This Our Power, Our Future, this launch is setting that platform. It's putting the tools in place to measure performance and to measure dedication and commitment and the like-mindedness in those that represent the community as a whole. And so I believe these four are an example of how we can duplicate this at this level, at the city level, at the county level, at the state level, and at the leadership level in our community overall.
And I would add also that there are certain branches of government. And so when you start, and you can't do it all. So we looked at where would have the biggest impact, and that is the Common Council. And not only the Common Council from a standpoint of its influence, but it's really at the ground level, the very ground level for the issues that impact our community. And then second, the visual, as you talked about, Bria, these individuals have agreed to the concept and be a part of this concept of leveraging their individual votes to create a collective, because they understand that to get anything passed, I think you need 9 votes, at least 9 votes. So that means it's for them. That means they got to go out and get 5 more votes in order for them to get something done. But having 4 to start with is very powerful.
That's right.
And that kind of togetherness is something that we are awarding and saying we're getting behind these people because this is the way it's done. And so we're going to branch out as we move forward. But clearly, we couldn't do everything to start out. And so now we're getting started. And so we have a very, very serious situation here in Milwaukee. And so if you want to get to the ground level and have the visual that we want to see, first holding African-Americans accountable to an agenda, then this is where we needed to start.
So we also have another one of our hosts that we are so happy to have on board joining us on the line. We have Troy Reese from T.O. Reese. How you doing, Troy?
I'm good. How you guys doing?
I'm good. I'm going to do like G and ask you, can you speak a little bit louder or step closer to whatever you're speaking into?
It reminds me of that song with the Isley Brothers, a little bit louder now.
The Can you write that?
Yeah, that was a 50 version. So that's all right. I get flashbacks every now. So don't mind me.
No problem.
So Troy, you called in at a perfect time. We were just speaking to G about the importance of having businesses and Black businesses at the table for this effort. And you definitely work with so many different people in the community, but you are a Black business and you know how important it is what we're doing. So what would be your shout out or your what you would share with people about tomorrow evening?
I mean, at the end of the day, without our businesses and our community, there is no opportunity for a lot of the individuals that need advancement in this city. So I think that tomorrow night is a great opportunity for us just to come together and get it kicked off. But the most important thing is for Black businesses to continue to strive and prosper. And the only way we can do that is by networking. So I think that this is a good start. And like you said earlier, a couple seconds ago, the individuals that you have here are these older women and men that are the ones that are really helping us as minority businesses to have an opportunity to prosper and grow. So at the end of the day, it's all positive when you come to an event that everyone is on the same page trying to make things better for our city. So.
Yeah, and Troy, we've had a lot of discussions, and I know your philosophy of trying to get as many Black men, because we know that we've stated on a number of occasions our community is out of position because our families are the Black families out of position. Our Black families out of position because our Black men is out of position, and our men are targeted in a number of different ways. And so the one of the biggest things that we can do is create sustainable jobs for our Black men. And to me, there's no greater skill that you can achieve and obtain that can give you independence for the rest of your life than learning a trade. And you provide that on a daily basis with your company. But I know your philosophy. So why don't you share, because most people might not understand some of the things you're doing and some of the challenges you might have as it relates to the whole workforce and what are you doing around the workforce, helping our Black men specifically.
Yeah, I think fundamentally, if you look at the construction trades, I'm a carpenter by trade, went to Milwaukee Tech High School, and I worked my way through the trades for a 4-year apprenticeship, and I was able to really understand the business. And you couldn't be more right. I mean, once you learn the carpentry trade, for instance, you will have a job for the rest of your life as long as you can physically do work. So when you learn a trade, you can set your own compensation based on what your abilities are. So I think that right now in our community, we're doing, hundreds of millions of dollars worth of construction. And the most important thing is the contractors that are getting these awards are really not only participating in a minority business as far as a minority-owned businesses aspect, but it's actually the workforce piece. So, some of the older women and men that you're talking to work with us, but we are working so hard to provide ways to get people sustainable jobs that are family-sustaining jobs. And the construction industry is an industry that if you have a driver's license and you have a GED or equivalency, that you can actually come in starting at least $15 an hour, working your way up to upwards of $40 or $50 an hour. And I think that it's important that more inclusion is made over time, that we can get more people into the trades. And we work very hard to provide opportunity, but you really have to take advantage of that opportunity once you get there. So I can speak for hours about this one, Rahim, because this is something that's passionate to me and something that we work very hard on every day. And we're working with the city of Milwaukee, MyWib, and a lot of different organizations to find money so we can get more training components for the trades in the city. Once we get the training back here in the city, it'll make a lot more opportunity for us.
Well, I want people that in the listening audience to understand this is a process. So in order for Troy and other Black contractors and general contractors and specialized contractors to be successful, they have to have access to opportunity. And there are opportunity that takes place both publicly and privately. So we need to have a significant access to those opportunities both publicly and privately. And so this is why we have to have the right politics. Our politics have to be right so that we can a voice and voice our concerns into the general community, the Milwaukee community, that if black contractors not getting adequate or equitable participation, it impacts all the way down the continuum. So it impacts the working force, the black working force, the black men. It impacts the trade level and the skill levels necessary, needed to be able to get, you said 4 years, and I'm sure that 4 year was uninterrupted, 4 years that we need to get enough work so that we can give people an opportunity to learn the skill, because this is a you got to learn these skills. You just can't show up and become a master plumber or a master carpenter or a sheetrock person. You're just not going to do that. You need to be able to be trained and sometimes on the job, but you need that practical experience on the job. And it is companies like Troy's company that will hire us. So this is the politics that we're going to now try to exercise. And one other aspect that we can play a role in that, Troy, is one of the things we want to do with our high school is the academy models. We want to bring back the whole concept of teaching our high school students more about the trades, and giving them a running start in life with the skill trades that we attempted to do. So, but now you can see, Troy, is kind of we pulling it all together, and so we have our politics right. Both by politics to the demand or command participation, equitable participation in both public and private development around the city, I think that it could feed down and not only grow businesses like yourselves, but also give the opportunity for you to help others as you've been doing. So I just want to make sure our public understands that this is the process. And this is the process that's going to take place is probably on almost every business sector.
So we are going to take a break. Troy and G, I don't know if you're going to hang with us. If you are, you're welcome to. If not, thank you for calling in. But we'd love to have you stay with us. We're going to take a break. When we come back, we're going to talk a little bit more about black lives and black votes. But then, you know, I'm going to put Mark on. Go ahead, Ryan.
Well, by the way, black lives don't matter if we don't do this. You know what
That's
I mean?
Right.
People talk about how black lives and they're protesting the black lives. If black lives will not matter if the black adults don't take the responsibility to fix these issues.
That's right.
These are very, very serious issues. And anybody who's in business, and Troy and G, you guys, and Mark, you in business, you know how serious it is to be in business. And so there's got to be an effort to grow our businesses. This has to be an effort to grow our business. And if that doesn't happen, black lives will never matter, because the most transformational thing that you can give a black life, a white life, a green life, a purple life is a job.
So we're going to talk some more about that. Raheem wants to give you a snippet so you can make sure you stay tuned.
I got a little excited.
I understand.
Tosha, right. You know. You know me.
I know. So we'll be back after the break. You're listening to Universally Speaking with Rahim Islam on 860 AM WNOV, The Voice.
The problem of the black people in America is inseparable from the problem of oppressed people all over the world. And until the leaders of black America realize that our problem is inseparable from the entire international problem, we will be considered a minority, will be considered an underdog, and will be begging for the things that we should have had when we were born.
I wouldn't suggest that they vote for any party or either party. I would suggest that the so-called Negroes become politically mature, realize the power that they hold in the field of politics, and then once the person who is running is aware that this man is awakened to the power that he holds, then that person who is running will approach that Negro on a more intelligent plane. As it is right now, most of the Negro leaders sell out to the white politicians for crumbs. And a political awakening among Negroes will make it impossible for the present Negro leaders to sell our people out as they've been doing in the past.
Anytime you have to pass a civil rights bill to make voter registration or voting opportunities increase for black people in this country, that in itself is a slap at the entire system of democracy. The only thing that will affect voter registration is when our own leaders form some kind of political education program that makes our people become more politically mature, politically alert, and aware of what their involvement and participation in politics will bring them. So it's not so much voter registration without voter education is a waste of time. Legislation will do neither.
Black man should control the politics and the politicians in his own community. The time when white people can come in our community and get us to vote for them so that they can be our political leaders and tell us what to do and what not to do is long gone. Okay. By the same token, the time when that same white man, knowing that your eyes are too far open, can send another Negro into the community, get you and me to support him so he can use him to lead us astray, those days are long gone. That if you and I are going to live in a black community, and that's where we're going to live, because as soon as you move into one of their, as soon as you move out of the black community into their community, it's mixed for a period of time, but they are gone, and you're right there all by yourself. We must understand the politics of our community, and we must know what politics is supposed to produce. We must know what part politics play in our lives. And until we become politically mature, we will always be misled, led astray, or deceived, or maneuvered into supporting someone politically who doesn't have the good of our community at heart. We will have to carry on a program, a political program of re-education to open our people's eyes, make us become more politically conscious, politically mature. And then we will, whenever we get ready to cast our ballot, that ballot will be cast for a man of the community who has the good of the community at heart. And once you change your philosophy, you change your thought pattern. Once you change your thought pattern, you change your attitude. Once you change your attitude, it changes your behavior pattern. And then you go on into some action. As long as you got a sit-down philosophy, you'll have a sit-down thought pattern. And as long as you think that old sit-down thought, you'll be in some kind of sit-down action. They'll have you sitting in everywhere. It's not so good to refer to what you're going to do as a sit-in. That right there castrates you. Right there it brings you down. What goes with it? What think of the image of someone sitting? An old woman can sit. An old man can sit. A chump can sit. A coward can sit. Anything can sit. Well, you and I have been sitting long enough, and it's time today for us to start doing some standing and some fighting to back that up.
Welcome back to Universally Speaking with Rahim Islam on 860 AM WNLP, The Voice. I am your co-host, Ptosha with a P. We have our esteemed host in studio with us today, Rahim Islam, and we also have on the line, we want to thank G from G's Clippers and everything else that he does in the city for calling in. G, I know you didn't get a chance to give a shout out to your Boy Scout troop also, but people just don't know all the different things that he does here in the community, so I want to thank you. We also have Troy Reese from TL Reese on the line with us, and joining us during the break we have Melissa Goins from Moore's Development. Hey, how you doing, Melissa?
Hey, everybody.
Hey.
Hey. One other thing I wanted to add to, I hope everybody was listening to Malcolm.
Malcolm,
I
mean, was throwing it, wasn't
I mean,
he?
I just hope and pray that. And then there's some things that he said that was not correct. They were correct for the time, I think. But
when he
I
said we the man we're going to elect?
No, I think the whole issue of activism and sitting and protesting. So because we need to incorporate that. But political maturity is something that is absolutely necessary. Having a philosophical change, and we talk about a paradigm shift that will lead to a new set of thought patterns. That's going to change behavior, because fundamentally there are two things that we got to get our hands around, and this is what we're attempting to do. One is internal strategy And that internal strategy is changing our behavior. I mean, that's what it really boils down to, is changing our behavior. And second, external strategy is that we still have to hold America, America's infrastructure, America's government, America's institutions accountable. Now, what that looks like, we'll define that ourselves. But we cannot do that if we're limping along. We've not matured politically, understand the political system. And so this is what this is about. So, and everybody can't handle all of this, you know, and I'm sure of it. But Malcolm had a way of just saying it. I mean, just in a much more, you know, forceful way. But we really have the responsibility. No one's going to do this for us except us. And that is a philosophical change to expect others to do for ourselves. When we're not prepared to do them for ourselves, it's ridiculous. So we're expecting people to fix our roads and fix our neighborhoods and fix our schools and fix this prison system and fix our health care and fix our business community and fix this and fix that and fix this. But the reality is they're not going to fix nothing. And we've watched as adults, most of us have watched as adults, we've watched those issues get worse. So I hate to get off into a... to a little tangent, but
come back to the light.
Yeah,
come back.
Talk me off the roof right now. But the bottom line is, you understand, I'm trying to get people to understand Malcolm was on point. That is the whole point. Now, the issue we're dealing with now is, how do we do it? How do we become politically mature? How do we take back our neighborhoods? How do we actually do these things? And that's what we're attempting to do starting tomorrow.
Okay. So we got a little bit further down the road with Rahim, but that's okay. Those of us who hang with him, we used to that. So, and Malele, keep calling. We're going to get you on. Thanks for calling in. Hold on, guys. We're going to get everyone in. Mark.
Hey.
How you doing?
The best I can.
So I want to get you in on this conversation. Before we get to where Rahim just left off at, we kind of ended the conversation talking about black businesses and what it takes to have infrastructure. And I'm thinking of a conversation Rahim said someone told him the other day about not having infrastructure and not having the ability to do things. But anyone who's ever had to make payroll and had people looking at them waiting to get paid, that's a different mindset. And so a lot of people may just have met you, you know, younger generations. Us old heads may know you back from Capitol Court, which they wasn't even called kiosk back then. It was a cart. That's you had a cart.
Yeah. Yeah, that's sure where I started. Thank you, Lord.
At Capitol Court, selling, you know, a lot of people don't even know that you are a firefighter, that, you know, you worked for Milwaukee Fire Department, you know, things you've done at the airport, all kinds of different things. You own car dealership. But you need to talk to them about why it's so important for you could just take your chips and say, I made mine, I'm going home. But why is what we're doing so important?
Well, the community has been good to me, you know, and God has been good to me. And so I know that I'm certainly charged to give back, you know, just as I have received. I have a grandson, I have a son, and it's important to me to help make the playing field a little bit more level or a little smoother for them, as well as for the sons of our community and the grandsons of our community. I know that I've heard, you know, throughout my years, I'm almost 60 years old. I've seen a lot go on here. I remember when the civil rights movement was really, really big, you know, let me not go to that. But I remember when a lot of things got started, and I see a real good game plan here. There have been many movements and many things have been started, and some just lacked the plan. You know, we many times go forth just based on an idea, and we confuse an idea and a plan. They are two different things. We have decided that, you know, the one thing that we have kind of lacked for a long time, had a whole bunch of good people, but just didn't have a cohesive playing team. So we needed to have some unity. We also needed to have some organization, and we also needed to have some growth. So those are three things that I think that those are three things that I feel that inside of this plan, our community will certainly be able to obtain. We have never had our community and our politicians working together at the beginning, you know, as a cohesive unit. And I just think that bigger than, you know, the businesses that I've been blessed to be able to have is that. I think that I'm so looking forward to tomorrow as a start off. And if we have 1,000 people or 200 people or just us, I'm so looking forward to what we're going to get ready to do. I know that we're going to unite with our politicians, and I know we're going to be good. And Bria said earlier that somebody said, well, why we start with these four? I'm just so glad we're getting started. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm just so glad we're getting started because today we haven't started with anyone in last week and last month and last year and the year mm-hmm. before that and the year before that. So the people who ask, why you start with these four? We really should have asked them, why you ain't picked you four and got started with you four? I mean, that's really what we should be asking them. But thank you, Lord, we can all be able to get started tomorrow. And even those who ask the questions can come. We can all be on the same team. We can help these four, and we can look forward to getting four more and then getting four more and then electing some more, you know, and growing what we have that comes from our community to benefit our community. I'm so looking forward to getting started tomorrow. You asked me about the businesses that I participate in. I guess from a quick place, I can say that I started in Capitol Court back in the 80s. I just wanted to have a Christmas season to make some money. Myself and a guy named Osaji Fo, who was my teacher, he and I worked together. And one year he ended up deciding that he was going to do something different. I wasn't able to go along out of town with him. I stayed here and opened up in Capitol Court for that Christmas season. I stayed there too. That was in 1988. I stayed till the mall closed. Certainly, if we ever look at anything, when we walked up to this building, we knew that the first step was a step to the next step to the step to the next step. So that was the next step to me to get me to a restaurant, which ended up getting me two stores in the airport, which ended up getting me to all the stores in the airport. It ended up getting me to myself and my team acquiring Boiling Honda, turning this all-star Honda, having an opportunity to build All-Star Acura and All-Star Buick, which, you know, we'll have shovels in the ground for those probably in about 3 or 4 months. Please don't think I was saying anything that I said to be self-grandizing. I was only saying it to say that I had partnerships, I formed alliances, and those were what blessed me, getting together with other people. I own absolutely nothing. I own some other stuff, too. I just ain't mentioning it. But let me say this. All of the things that I own them jointly with other people. I own absolutely nothing by myself. And I'm not saying I own something with my son, I own something with my brother. Other people from other families have come together, and we have decided to pool our resources, pool our ideas, and then pool our energies. And if our community does the exact same thing, just the common folks in our community, with the common folks that's downtown, with the common folks that's working in business, because we all just common folks, every now and then we get to do some uncommon things. Mm-hmm. So if we would just take our all common selves, collectively decide that we're going to organize and unify and grow together. Yeah, from that four that we starting with, yeah, we're going to grow to eight. We're going to grow to, or maybe we might not grow to eight. Maybe we go to five, then to six, then to seven, mm-hmm. then to eight. But we're going to grow. If we get together, we can't lose. So I think I talked longer than I meant to, but I'm almost out of stuff. Thank you.
So I want to thank you, Mark. I also want to thank our callers that are on the line. Melissa, I want to pose the same question to you with your development company. What does coming together for an event like tomorrow, you know, what does it mean to you, and why are you involved in something like this?
That's a great question. I've been sort of sitting on the line trying to think about where I can contribute to the conversation. And one thing that defines who I am is I'm a mother of three precious folks.
Can you turn your radio down just a little bit?
It's off.
Okay, she said it's off.
Yes, it's off. Can you hear me?
Yep. Okay. Well, Malele, if it's you, can we have you turn your radio down? We're getting an echo. I'm sorry for interrupting, Melissa.
But I do have you on speaker, so I can take it off a speaker.
Okay, maybe that's it. Thank you.
Is that better?
Yes, thank you.
Oh, okay. Awesome. So one of the things that that graciously defines me, defines who I am as a person, is being a mother. And I have three children, two boys and a daughter. And in raising my children, it really helps me to appreciate how starting with little people is very important. And so a part of what my big motivation is to show them that anything is possible. And then I think about how, you know, I was raised, how my parents were raised, and my grandparents were raised, and their parents before that and before that. And we all have and we all carry with us a lot of stress and damage, not pointing blame, but just stating a fact. And one of my personal struggles has been to try to figure out how to be who I am in a world that tells me that I'm not nothing. And so going back to your question, as far as being able to contribute to an event like this, I think it's one, a moral imperative, but two, it's something inside of me that guides me and directs me to contribute to, you know, my. And so my background is born and raised urban Milwaukee, so it's all I know. And there are a lot of people who look in Milwaukee and say, nah, I want to be there. But one of my conscious choices, and maybe not so conscious, more so like spiritual nudges, is this is the work you're supposed to do. And so how do you leverage this life, Melissa, to be able to benefit others, not just those lives that I've created, but those lives of people that look like me and look like my family. And so I think my contribution to tomorrow is to say, well, one, I'm selfish in that I want to be around some good Black energy. There is not much culture that we have in Milwaukee, and so I'm selfish in that I want to be around some good energy. And two, you know, in the work that I do, which is real estate development, we're known for doing apartment buildings in urban Milwaukee. The work is hard work. And it would be nice to have counterparts that look like me in this industry. And it's not easy to do, but the more that we have allies in this work, whether it's construction, whether it's car dealerships or barbershops or restaurants, I think that's for us all.
And we are so, so very excited to have you as one of our hosts tomorrow. And we also have on the line, we kind of flipped the script here. The ladies are outnumbering the men now. We have Alderwoman Malele Cox on the line. Melissa, you stay on the line. We're going to block the line, you and Malele. How you doing, Alderwoman?
I am well, and you?
I'm good. Have you been listening?
Hi, Malele.
Yes, I am. Hi, Melissa.
I can't hear her.
Okay, so Malele, thank you for calling in. It was funny when we were going through the pictures today, and I looked and I said, you know what, I've spoken to all of these council people today just on stuff unrelated to the event tomorrow. But I want to know, as one of the four of our guests who will be joining us tomorrow, what does an event like this mean to you and your colleagues? Have you talked about it? What are you expecting? What is it that you want to do when you come out to meet the community tomorrow?
Well, it's a few things. And I think something that I often, before I ran for office, I managed campaigns for other individuals for office. And one thing I always will share with the candidates that I worked with was this. Politics is a science, and we have to become the scientists. There are strategies to how you win a victory. It's not just that you end up one day in the seat or in City Hall and get to make these very critical decisions for our community. You got to get there in the first place. And to get there, part of that science is the very things like what's being launched off tomorrow. It's the conduits, it's the PACs, it's the people, the allies who are there to support you financially, manpower-wise, issue-wise, and everything else. So, you know, for a long time, you know, our community will get real riled up and engaged for an election. But we rarely are galvanized like we should be consistently behind leadership as well as issues that we need to be. So it's great to see this effort taking place, and I'm just grateful to be a part of it. But my hope is that it's the beginning of something really great for this city, because as all these great things occur with our city, it's other people seeing the opportunity. But as we know, our community has suffered a lot So it's like, how do we make sure that in this opportunity that our community gets to take full advantage of it and benefits from it as well?
So I don't know if that's, Lele, if that's your baby crying or talking, trying to get on the mic, or if that's Melissa baby trying to get on the mic.
We both have babies.
Y'all both have babies, but we want your babies to know that we hear them and that we doing all of this for them, for their future. So we're not leaving them out. We can hear them. We hear their voice. Yeah. We hear what they got to say.
They got to talk English.
They're saying, "Let's unite."
Yeah.
That's so,
and baby.
And baby talk. That's right. They getting their message across. So, and I also want to thank you ladies, because in a, you know, if you look at the Common Council right now, Malele, you are the only female on the Common Council, and Melissa can speak to this too. Also, in the field of work that she's in, there are not many women, black women, who are doing the jobs that both of you are doing, Malele. And, you know, I know that you would love to have another conscious black woman on the council with you, you know, to help you fight the fight. So back to what Mark was saying, you know, let's feed that pipeline and let's elect four more. You know, let's start with one and two and three and four. And the same with Melissa. You know, it's all about us working together and collaborating and trying to see what we can do to help each other. Back to the infrastructure question.
Well, I want to put a couple of things for Melissa and also Malele. Put some structural things in place, because this is why it's very important, and that we have an agenda, number one. And two, I mean, our agenda is very clear. We need to create economic opportunity. And in the real estate development, the leader of that process are the developers. So the developers, the role that Melissa plays is very, very critical to start the ball rolling. Because if developers are not developing, the contractors will not get the work. The contractors will not get the work, and then hire the subcontractors and the workers and the like. So none of this gets started until we can have a very healthy development community taking place. So that's number one. And then number two, you talked about, Malele, you talked about, we can hear, I've been with several governors and several, even presidents, they can talk about the economic growth of America or the economic growth of a region, and yet our community is still in decline. So obviously that there's a concept that they use all the time, rising tide lifts all boats. But the reality is that we don't have enough boats in the water, and those boats are the business community. So there's going to have to be an agenda to increase the amount of real estate development activity at the highest level, with African Americans leading the way, and it's going to have to be also a significant amount of black businesses entering the business. And what Mark said was, not being braggart, but basically all of the experiences he had helped forge the experience for the next project he was doing or the next business he was doing. So we got to get that continuum moving in order for us to, we just can't go jump from elementary school to high school, or we're not going to jump from developing one house to be able to develop 1,000 houses. So is that process, all that has to be coordinated. So I wanted to make sure structurally that the role of development is very critical in this process, and also the role of Malele ensuring that we carve out a way for black businesses to grow, in spite of the fact that they're sometimes going to be at the very beginning of the process. We have to figure out how to prime that pump and get that pump, that pipeline primed, so that we can get some kind of consistency on the back end. So I just wanted to open that up, and either one of you can respond to what I just said.
Yeah, I think it's an exciting time for, I would say, downtown Milwaukee, with billions literally of dollars in development that's taken place, and it's intriguing to watch the cranes and to watch the momentum. But one of the questions tying to what happens tomorrow with OPOF is, who is that benefiting? And so you have billions of dollars going into an area of town where the wealth are getting wealthier, and people with money aren't necessarily willing to share. And so an organization like what we're supporting can say, okay, I'm glad that you have money and you have your network of folks, But how do we make sure that this is more inclusive? And it's a fight that a lot of us individually try to take up. And, for example, Troy and I do it collectively. I do developments. He gets contract work. And so it's a partnership in that regard. But the more, and Malele ties into this too, the more that we empower our politicians to fight for our ability to have more, and the more of us that are ready to take advantage of those opportunities, the better we are in the long run. And one of the themes of the gentleman's speeches when they called in earlier is, you know, it's our sort of responsibility to give back. So as politicians can set up the work, we can be available to do the work, but then we also have the responsibility to support the larger community once we're successful in our individual fields.
Malele?
You know, Melissa is exactly right. You know, we often hear the rhetoric about the level of, in this case right now in front of us, development that plans to take place in the city of Milwaukee. I think over the next 5 to 10 years, the estimate that the Commissioner of City Development has been quoting is well over $3 billion in development. But we know all too often, as Rahim was pointing out, you could see that $3 billion come and go and still have green boards on the houses in our community.
Absolutely.
And our neighborhood, and still have the poverty levels and still have the unemployment levels, as long as very intentional efforts are not made for inclusion of our community in on those projects at all levels, not just the construction jobs, but also with the business opportunities as well. And I think my colleagues, those of whom who are also on the flyer for tomorrow, we just got through with a very hectic budget in which we let it be known to the mayor and whoever else the priority that our inclusion has to be, so much so that we sponsor legislation for the creation of a position to aid in that effort of connecting those dots, and also the hiring of several additional people to make sure that for the residential preference hiring that people don't fake addresses and try to get over. You know, when you got $3 billion on the table, it's going to be all kind of stuff people pull to make sure that only they benefit from it. So from a million different angles, we've attempted to what we can do legislatively to make sure that it counts from our community, and we're not done yet. So much so, though, that I don't know if you all saw, but last week in the mayor's veto address for the budget, because he vetoed one of the elements that we put into the budget, he said that now he is going to take on, in the next 90 days, presenting a strategy on how to make sure that all of this development does reach our community. So he should be unveiling that in 3 months. But his message was that he heard us loud and clear that this, it's not going to go down like that. And my colleagues, you know, Alderman Hamilton, Alderman Sanford, and Alderman Wade, and I often discuss how we wouldn't be doing our jobs if we allowed these billions of dollars to come into downtown Milwaukee and didn't make sure that our community did not benefit from it as well.
Well, I think it's critical, and the way you both of you described your participation is absolutely essential. The challenge for us that we've been missing, and I've seen this across the country, is having a strategic place where all of those, we could deposit that energy, similar to the partnership that you described, Melissa, with Troy, and similar to some of the action items, for example, that Melita, you just described about that you were able to achieve, but I think you could even achieve even more if the community understood what it is you were fighting for. And that they were also aware, understood that these are the issues, these are things that have to be delivered on. And what I've seen, I know there's some people who don't want to see this happen, and I'm very, very aware of that. But what I've seen, for the most part, is there has been a general belief that other people know what's best for us. And so that kind of attitude is so slavish, you know, that we have to break that cycle. And so one of the things we created was a priority issue focusing on the economics. Because at the end of the day, if it doesn't solve all our problems, it solves most of them. Economics will. I mean, it might not solve all of our problems, but most of them can be much more manageable when there is an equitable distribution of wealth, there's an equitable distribution of the economy, and there's more equitable participation in the economy that this economy is being created by all of us. So, but someone has to not articulate that strategy. Someone has to then defend that strategy, and then also someone has to hold everyone accountable in that strategy. And I think that's what we're attempting to do. So we created a series of priority issues that I'm sure that are that both of you are not very much aware of, but most of them are, again, the paradigm shift of if we're going to you know, resolve the issues in the black community, the black people are going to have to do them. And so by however means necessary that we can achieve those, that has to be the fight the next 10, 15 years. We have to get in front of the issues that impact us, both economically and socially. So, you know, I'm glad to, that you, both of you guys are on board. Thank you so much.
Ladies, we're going to take a break. You're welcome to stay on the line. And I know Rahim wants some of the guys to call in, but you're welcome to stay on the line and join us or drop off and just listen after the break. But we want to thank both of you for calling in. It is so important, and we look forward to seeing you tomorrow. We are going to take a break. Go ahead, Rahim.
Well, I was just thinking about what what Marcus said, and it really kind of bothers me. It really bothers me because it's unfair. It's very easy for us to look at the practical side of things that we see happening for other people. Mm-hmm. But when it comes down to us, we get very impractical.
And why can't it happen right away? What's well, it take yeah, so yeah. long?
And we're not going to reverse. And I just want to manage expectations. You know, it says, you know, well, how do you... You said it, Mark, take one step and then the next step and then the next step. The issue is that you're making the step. So, brothers and sisters, I'm not going to kid you. We're in a pickle. Mm-hmm. We're in a very, very serious situation. We're under attack in every way you can imagine. And those who are owners of businesses and those who are inside the political government, like Malele, she understands she's in that fight. She knows what's going on. She sees what's going on. She sees the play that's being taken place. And in spite of all the things that are happening, most people don't even know what's going on. So we're in a fight for our lives. Right. So we're not going to overnight change the conditions that have, you know, been built up over 400-something years. But here's what the hope is. The hope is that there is no metrics we can put together, when we put powerful black people together, and as Melissa said, the first thing is the selfishness about having, being in a place where a lot of positive black people. There's no metrics that we can measure the outcome, what would take place when black people come together. And yeah, we're going to have some people who are knuckleheads and don't really believe and they just really faking it. That's fine. But
once we start working together, we can't lose.
Well, let me just tell you something. We said, Mark, myself, and Mr. Jones said, we were going to get it done with or without you. We're going to get this thing started. And we've grown. Now we got Bria, we got Ptosha, we got a whole list of people, G and Melissa and Quabana. And the list goes on and on and on and on.
So it's
going to happen, but I
we
tell you
start
what,
working together.
We just got to break the cycle. We got to break that cycle. So I hate to take you off on a little tangent, but I'm just feeling some kind of way.
You know what? You can have your tangents today. Well, this is powerful.
Well,
I'm
feeling some kind of way that understanding the psychology of our community, and we got to fight the psychology that divides us. We got to fight the psychology of hopelessness. Mm-hmm. We got to fight the psychology of defeat. Mm-hmm. But it ain't going to happen until we make it happen. And no one's going to come out of the sky, come up from the ground, or come out of the water and do for us what we must do for ourselves. Mm-hmm. We got to do it.
You wait, Mark. Every time you look, you like.
No, they're not coming. If they're coming out of that sky, I guarantee we're running.
Okay, we're going to talk some more about that after the break. We got to pay some bills. We'll be back after the break. You're listening to Universally Speaking with Rahim Islam on 860 AM WNLV, The Voice. Welcome back to Universally Speaking with Rahim Islam on 860 AM WNOV, The Voice. We are so excited. This has been a very special show today. We've been talking about Black Lives Matter and Black Votes Matter and the launch of the Our Power, Our Future conduit that is going to take place tomorrow, November 17th at 6 p.m. at Skybox Sports Bar, 2213 North MLK Jr. Drive. We want you all to come out. We will take any contribution, a quarter, a dollar, 50 cent, $2, $5, $10, $2,000, $200,000.
Yeah, well, make it worth it, though. Come on. Come on, make it worth it. Come on.
My last $2.
Make it worth it.
And a lot of us, like, focus on the fact that, like, man, Obama, he made this a campaign. He was only asking people for $5. He was asking for people for $5 that only had $5.
Mm-hmm.
It was he got some $50,000 and some $100,000 donations.
Right. Feel free to come on with that $100,000 if you got it. You are more than welcome. Keon said, okay, we count you in, Keon. Mm-hmm. Thank you. I believe we still have on the line with us Malele and Melissa.
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, great. So I want to get into a little bit, you know, Rahim has, every time we go to break, has really done a very good job of explaining why it is that we're doing this. This isn't just something that just, you know, out of blue a couple weeks ago, we just said, oh, you know what, we don't have nothing else to do. Let's just launch a conduit. This has been something that's been in the works for 3 years. And I know a lot of you are saying, well, wait a minute, I'm confused. I thought you were talking about Milwaukee community leaders. We are. We're still talking about Milwaukee community leaders. But there has to be one first step, which is what Mark talked about. You can't get to the second step without taking the first step. And right now, we are in the middle of political season. And those who are savvy and who even are not savvy about that understand, maybe they don't understand what that means, which is what Malcolm X was talking about. That we, you said Malcolm 10. Malcolm X was talking about that there needs to be an education about this whole process and why it matters. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that. Rahim's most recent article for Universally Speaking in the Milwaukee Courier, please go to Milwaukee Courier online. It's called Another Message to the Community. Black lives will only matter when the black vote matters. We started talking about this a little bit on Friday, and I thought that some of the points that Rahim made were just outstanding, and he shared a little bit in studio, but I just want to read a little bit more for you. After all, some black people executed unspeakable atrocities on their own. My prayer is that those individuals who knowingly sold out or inflicted these atrocities upon their own people be relegated to a special place in Hades. Oh, you was being nice. In addition to the undermining...
That's called editing. I said hell.
In addition to the under... I was giving you credit for being nice.
Oh, no.
In addition to the undermining and changing of the narrative of our freedom fighters, we have allowed the media, education, institutions, and now public opinion to promote and advocate the false perception that America has successfully eradicated racism. Because this false narrative has been so carefully crafted and marketed, both white and black generations to come will conclude that blacks are the cause of their own devastation. This false narrative of blaming the victim is the most lethal form of white supremacy and black inferiority. Think about it. If we erase or revise our history to believe that everything is equal and there is an even playing field, how do we account for the carnage in the black community? One must deduce that if the black group isn't advancing in this free market, there must they must bear the blame, and in effect, they are inferior, never taking into account capital disadvantage, the deplorable education struggle that continues today, and the latest, newest, and most diabolical trick to silence Black people, the mass incarceration of Black men. While there is a discussion on the impact of mass incarceration of Black men, this discussion takes place in the most condescending way imaginable. Specifically, this topic is spoken as a matter of fact, and that it is just the way it is, without describing the massive human rights violations that it presents to the whole notion that Black lives matter. The mass incarceration of Black men is modern-day slavery, in that the impact is just as lethal and will have long-term consequences that, if not addressed now, if we don't address it, the issue will concert its distressing impact on the Black community. America has by far the largest imprisoned population in the world. Regardless of how the metrics that we use to examine incarceration in America, the rate of incarceration is number one, i.e. per capita, actual number, et cetera, et cetera. America has a dubious distinction of being the world's number one human rights violator with the incarceration of the Black minority. This type of human rights violation has not been seen in the 6,000 years of the world's documented history. Black men who are targeted by America represent approximately 4% of the nation's population, but make up nearly 55% of the prison population. These percentages are equivalent to the numbers of fatalities that resulted from the world's most devastating earthquakes. The mass incarceration helps to support and sustain a climate and culture within law enforcement, courts, and the penal system that absolutely devalues Black life. So when we, you know, I love to tie it all together. There is a method to the madness. There is a reason. There's the steps that you'll probably see that in one of the articles, Mark. You know, your steps. Raheem's going to, as Mark Wade so eloquently put it, those steps, taking those first steps. All these meetings, all these radio shows, all the writing that Raheem does in the Black papers, not just here in Milwaukee, but across the country. All of these discussions are leading to the fact that we need to organize and come together if we're going to have any type of an impact on these statistics that he lays out. And these aren't numbers that he's making up. He's doing the research, pulling the information down, and sharing it with you. So we have to decide how we're going to come together. And we have to work together and organize. And tomorrow is just the start of one of many things that you'll see. When you attend the event tomorrow, guess what? We're going to have the save the date for the next event in December. We're going to have more information on Black Votes Matter. We're going to have information on registering to vote, how you can help, how you can come together. So, yes, it is about, as Mark and G both stated, writing a check. We do need you to write a check because we can't do this for free. However, there are going to be many, many things coming up that we need your support in. And this is just the beginning of us galvanizing and coming together so we can see that effort come to light.
After we talk about it, too, people will be able to clearly see that it'll be well worth their while. And when we pool our resources, pool our dollars, it's easy to turn, you know, a number that's like really insignificant to you. Once we put several insignificant numbers together, it ends up being a number that is significantly and significantly impactful, you know, on behalf of our community. Mm-hmm. You know, and the thing is that people just have to understand that we are a very suspicious people, and our suspicions are very warranted because people have been hurt and people have been damaged. But at some point, we're going to have to understand that we have not been coming in first place. Mm-hmm. We have not. And we can't continue to do the same things and keep on saying we suspicious and keep on saying we not trusted and keep on saying we don't want to take a chance and we don't want to unite and we don't want to organize. Because it's always, as I always tell my son and my grandson, it's always, no matter what it is you think of, it's always a reason not to. Always
That's
a
right.
reason not to.
That's right.
We're going to have to get to a place where we decide that we're going to unify, we're going to organize, and we're going to grow. And, you know, what the plan is for tomorrow it's going, that plan is going to grow. It's not going to stay the same. It'll grow. If we get together, it's going to grow.
Melissa and then Malele, we'd like you to join in. Do you have some comments or something you'd like to share?
Yeah, I had a few thoughts. My little lady is about to join the conversation, and I know we don't want too much of that. But what was my thought? So before we went to break, Rahim started talking about, in a very passionate way, the psychology of us as a people. And I don't think I tie back my point as far as my pride with respect to being a mother. And I think it's so important that we are really able to just appreciate. Is she really loud, y'all?
Keep going.
Oh, okay. Because I know she's loud in here with me, so I didn't know how it was impacting the radio.
No, she's
but,
fine.
But I think that that psychology piece is so extremely
Let
important.
Me hear her voice.
Huh?
Let me hear a voice.
Keep going, Melissa. Keep going.
That psychology piece is extremely important, especially as you were, like, reading your the piece that Rahim wrote. It's one of the three. You make 3 points, one being the wealth disparity, the education disparity, and the mass incarceration. So going back to being a mother of not just black men in America, but also of a daughter, is my responsibility as a parent to them, in my opinion, to keep their thoughts pure as possible. And it's not a an easy task. And I'm listening to Mark talk about how we are very suspicious people. At the end of the day, as hard as it may sound, the choice is always ours. In my portfolio, we have probably approaching 300 apartment units. And if you put an escalator on that, say 300 apartment units, probably 2 to 3 people occupying each. That's probably 600 to 900 people that I take personal responsibility for. So how in my work do I do my apartments to develop neighborhoods, but then also have these people who are living in my building and then also empower them? And so it's really about us recognizing that we have the power, and Mark used the word, insignificant with respect to donations. Everything matters, even if it's your presence, because if we can open up or tap into just a little bit inside of you, then you can share that with somebody and share that with somebody. And then we really have the foundation of what can be a really powerful movement.
Absolutely. Malele?
Yeah. You know, I again echo the sentiments that everybody else has expressed. And to just say this, as a legislator, or quote-unquote politician, I consider myself more of a public servant than a politician, but we are only as powerful as the people we represent. So the need to strategize, to organize, and to recognize what the issues are and how we want them to be addressed is key for us who are in elective office to be able to do the job that we are put there to do and to do it well. You know, they often say leadership is a lonely trail to be on, because a lot of times you're out there by yourself. I believe what we take with us, though, is for us at the city, the 40,000 people that we represent. But when that community is unaware, doesn't know, or doesn't have a way to have a voice, it makes it difficult to be able to be that empowered decision maker that you need to be. So I see tomorrow as a great opportunity for a beginning of a way for us here in Milwaukee to be organized in that political voice and using it to the best of our abilities. Because I know that you all, like I am, are tired of people only coming to our community right before an election to get us riled up, to get us out to vote. But in the end, still not addressing our issues. And in the end, still not, you know, our incarceration rates haven't changed with a different election. Our health disparities and stuff haven't changed, or at least have not improved with the different elections. And part of that issue, I think, is whenever people run for office, I don't think that in this town they're held accountable enough for the issues that impact our community. So that once they get in, even if it wasn't your candidate, whoever gets in should still have to deal with our issues.
Absolutely.
And the reality becomes, if we didn't get the person or the entity that we was trying to push, it's like they feel like they don't owe us nothing. And that's not just something me as a
a political person is seeing. It's our reality.
Right.
It's what you see in our community every single day. And to me, that changes when we have a voice, not only in the elections, but beyond the elections. You demonstrate your power during the elections, but you keep that power going even when it's not an election. Because people listen to the numbers. People listen to the voices. People listen to when you can have people show up, when a vote is being cast or issue is being discussed, it makes those who may not have normally cared about our issue or seen our side of it begin to open their eyes and care a little bit more when we demonstrate the power that we have. So I see tomorrow as a great opportunity to begin all of that, because whether it is the unemployment levels, the incarceration rates, the health disparities, the list goes on and on and on. I know that you all, just like I am, are tired of Milwaukee being at the top of the list for every single socioeconomic negative indicator that there could be for African Americans in this country. But the way that is going to change is going to change because of us. And tomorrow, just one small piece of that I see.
Well, one of the things that I see in Milwaukee, and I'm in a few cities, and I've never seen it as much as I've seen it in Milwaukee, is the knowledge about how bad things are, or the many of different studies that have been taken, and puts Milwaukee number one or number one, the worst place to live for Black people. And my position is this: first and foremost, that kind of the race to how bad is bad, you know, is I see that argument all over the place. Well, I'm bad and you're bad, but the reality is that we all struggle in America. There's not a black, very few places in America where Black people are prospering as a group. Mm-hmm. Now, we might have some individual things that may appear like we're making progress, but as a group, we're struggling. And the point I wanted to make is that wouldn't it be great if we could create, and this is part of the vision, if this is the worst place for Black people, that we could make it the best place for Black
best,
people?
Best opportunity.
You know, so yeah. To me, that I look at it as, look, if that's, and here's what I say also that is fundamental, and Malala, you understand this probably better than most, especially to our listening audience, is that when government is not working correctly, we need government to work as best as it could possibly work in order for us to move our agenda, especially when our agenda is not presented in any kind of global, holistic way. When we piecemeal in the issue of incarceration, or we're piecemeal in the issue of economics, or we're piecemeal in the issue of education, when all those things are being piecemealed, they don't really have the desired effect, because all of those issues impact our community. So when government is not working, when the executive office is not working with the legislative office, and when the county is not working with the city, and the city is not working with the county, and the county is not working with the state, and vice versa, and the state is not working with the federal government, I mean, there are people who say, who cares? They're going to be fine. But our community suffers and have suffered significantly on this dysfunction. And so one of the first things we need to do, and we need your group to do, is to exercise its power with its influence of its caucus. And so when I've seen the work that you've done, and I'm extremely impressed by you and the work that you've done, and I've also listened to you talk, you're not apologetic about what positions you take, and you're not apologetic about defending our community. So when I hear those kind of things, I think that we have the workings to change this thing, but we have to get government to work, and politics. In politics, many people don't understand it's about trading, it's about strategizing, it's about getting partnerships and allegiances and pulling together enough groups that, you know, you do for me and I'll do for you, but the question for doing for me will ultimately impact our community. So I'm really, really, I don't have any problem when I have to say, why are we supporting you guys? Because I've seen all four of you guys in action, and I'm extremely impressed with, especially Malala, I'm extremely impressed with you and your convictions and your passion for our community, and you don't have any problem of you have no problem whatsoever of saying what's on your heart and what's on your mind to people who think they're more powerful or more stronger than you, and I'm really appreciative of that.
Ladies, can we get some...
Can I just say something real quick?
Yeah, I want you... I want both of you all, if you have some ending comments regarding this whole thing and tomorrow, I want you to both of you, first Malele, and then you, Melissa.
I first want to thank all the sponsors who are making tomorrow possible and making this whole movement possible. It's been much needed, and I know many have tried in the past, but I just appreciate the efforts being made and being included in those efforts. So first, I just want to say that. Second, I just want to say the time for politics as usual, the time for us to be quiet and wait our time, the time for us not to speak up unapologetically for our community is over because of the conditions that our community is in. Like being polite, being nice about it, trying to care about everybody else's feelings, we can't afford to do that anymore. So part of my motivation with the way that I speak to the issues of our community is with that in mind, that it's no time to be, you know, meek and mumble mouth about it. Secondly, to emphasize exactly what you were talking about, Rahim, Wisconsin is the testing ground for so many different legislative initiatives that has helped to put our community in the condition that it's in, whether it is W-2, whether it is Act 10, whether it is a whole slew of other things that have been done legislatively to help our community be in the condition that it's in, then copy in other cities and other states nationwide. It does lend to the thought that if we are so pliable to be utilized for these policies that end up impacting us negatively, how pliable would we be to flip that and do some great and positive things that help to pull us out of the conditions that we're currently in? So I'm a believer in exactly what you were talking about, that's what needs to happen. And Milwaukee can be that place that turned it around. And, you know, and I want to be a part of that turnaround, and I thank you all for being a part of that turnaround as well. And I look forward to seeing you all and everybody else who will be there tomorrow night. Thank you.
Thank you, Alderwoman.
Thank you.
Melissa?
I love when Malele speaks, and she knows it. If I was had a chance at a different life, I definitely have the ability to spit on the mic. I just ain't got that. I'm more of a doer and a worker type, but Malele said a lot, and I'll just say I shade to her comments. And because of who I am, no matter if those four folks on those flyers didn't do anything at all, I'm voting for them and I'm giving them my money because they're Black. But the beauty is that they actually do put in the work, and that's why I'm glad to be a part of this event, to support their work, but then also to support us all coming together to make some things happen. And I just got to say, I'm humbled and appreciative to be one of the sponsors for the event tomorrow night. And I'm also the youngest one on that flyer. So I'm glad to learn from my elders. And I look forward to seeing everybody tomorrow.
Thank you, Melissa. And we look forward to seeing you tomorrow, too. I also wanted to make
an elder, though.
She just stated the facts.
Want to make it very clear. Okay. I'm not an elder.
The facts. Just the facts. Thank you, ladies, both. And we look forward to seeing both of you
Absolutely.
Tomorrow. And
thank you so much
for joining us by calling in. I also want to make a point to point out that all elected officials are invited tomorrow. Mm-hmm. This is not saying, you know, these four and nobody else can come. And I want you to know that we've reached out to them. They will be there to support their colleagues. Mm-hmm. They are coming. So this is about coming together. This is not about separating and this person over that person, because who knows what the next event will be for, who will be, as Mark said, you know, we still got to go through the county. We still got, I think it was Bria, the county, the federal, all the other different areas of government here. So everyone is invited to come out tomorrow. All elected officials are invited to come out tomorrow. You're not invited to come and campaign, but you are invited to come to the launch and join us in coming together. So, Rahim, it's getting close to that time. I told you we'd go fast, Mark.
Well, one of the things I think
is it over already.
one of the things that I think, and I was being making a joke about being an elder, but hey, fine.
We have chairs, Mark. Them have chairs, soft chairs upstairs for the elder. Yeah, we got an elder circle.
Well, I'll stand up. How about that? No, but the this effort is being. We have a cross section of male and female, and young and old, educated, uneducated. It doesn't make a difference. And one of the things that I said earlier, cause somebody texted me that I said that was wrong with Malcolm's speech. And what was wrong with Malcolm's speech is when you build a movement, everybody is important. Those who want to sit down mm-hmm. and protest, mm-hmm. and those who want to walk into the halls of government and try to win in that environment. We don't have the luxury as a people to negate anybody, mm-hmm. And also to not value what they bring to the table. And that's a belief and a passion that we could do better as a community. So the movement is about anybody bringing anything to the table. And so somebody said, they asked me, well, who's the leader? You the leader. If you're prepared to bring it and you're prepared to take the ownership, you got it. Mm-hmm. But you can't take on the ownership and be not prepared to do the work. We don't need a bunch of people who can just tell people what to do. Mm-hmm. The people who are sitting in here and others that are working, we are people who are doing the work, you know, and it doesn't make a difference. A title doesn't make a difference. It's not about a title war or a leadership. For us, we're talking about servant leadership. Who is going to serve our community? Who's going to take off their fake, because I believe it's a fake title and fake hat of when our community is dying. So we got to be able to serve our community. And people talk about we should be doing this and we should be doing that and we should be doing this. Well, who's going to do it? We've decided to do it.
Right.
We've decided that we're going to do it. And the bottom line is that it comes with a lot of sacrifice. I heard somebody say it's lonely. I think Malele said mm-hmm. leadership is a lonely position. It's a lot of sacrifice. It takes a lot to do this. We've been at this in Milwaukee alone for 3 years, meeting with people, trying to convince them to have a bigger vision and show that their role in this process, we are holding ourselves back. I was writing something, and I'm glad I didn't even give it to Ptosha because it was actually a frustration that I've never felt before of seeing black people who are really the problem. They're really the problem. Because you can't be a leader if you're not asking for a connection with your brother and your sister. If in spite of the problems we're having as a community and you're not getting out of your comfort zone to go to the next church if you're a pastor or you're a legislator, you're not going out of your office and going to the next office, or you're a business person, you're not getting out of your business office and going to another office and asking, can we do something together? Come on, you are really the hope and the prayer that you will come into a position of leadership and you're not leading, you are absolute disappointment. An absolute disappointment. So it is the leaders who are failing our community. Our community is in trouble because our leaders are in trouble. And that's the problem. So all of us are not feeling that way. Some of us need a help. They need a support. This is gonna be that support. We need an infrastructure we can place into. So the people, for whatever reason, have figured it out and got it to a point, and we can get a starting point. But I'm telling you, there's no magic to this. You get what you earn. You get what you work for. And if our community is not prepared to work for it, we won't get it. We'll keep this nonsense and this rhetoric about the revolution and the revolution and the revolution and ain't prepared to do nothing. We're not prepared to even vote. We're not prepared to even go out and get votes. We're not prepared to get people to write checks for certain things. We're not prepared to support anything. It's about nonsense. It's a big conversation. So now it's time to put up or shut up.
That's right.
Put up. Well, shut up. And don't give me that nonsense about you don't trust somebody. You don't trust. Well, who do you trust then? You can't say that about the people you're supporting, the people that you're following. And they don't have, they have clearly shown you they don't care nothing about you. And black lives don't matter. Mm-hmm. But you trust them? So let's stop the rhetoric and the nonsense and the BS and the silliness and be adults. Let's be grown-ups. Let's be adults about the situation and be adults and let's handle our business. And this is the business of our community. Handle the politics of our community. Handle the business of our community. Handle the education of our community. Let's handle our own business. That means we have to be men and women and not chumps. That's and not right. Children. Not females and males. And that's a heck of a thing to say, but it's our reality. We're not going to get out of this pickle until we decide it's time for us to get out. It's, Rahim can't do it. Mark can't do it. Ptosha can't do it. Bria can't do it. Mr. Jones can't do it.
We can.
But we can.
Amen.
So, caller, we want to thank you for holding. We are not able to take your call
I'm
today.
I'm sorry. Raheem okay. went on another
That's
tangent
okay. however,
again. But
Guess what?
What's that?
You're going to get to share some more tomorrow on the forum with Sherwin Hughes.
Oh, okay.
He will
okay.
be back. So hold those calls. Call in tomorrow during the show.
All right.
He will be on the forum at 11:30. With one of your colleagues on the forum with Sherwin Hughes tomorrow at 11:30. So if it was somebody that you wanted them to hear about this and they didn't get a chance to listen tonight, tell them to tune in tomorrow at 11:30.
Thank you, WNOV. Thank you, Mr. Jones, because I got to say this. Mr. Jones has been behind the scenes, and Mark will say it. I mean, he's been like a pillar in Man. This community, Since. But he's been a pillar to this whole movement. Since. He's been an absolute... really, if you want to blame somebody, blame him, because he's given me enough freedom and enough support to do the things that we're doing in writing and talking and also organizing at every level. I can't even begin to tell you how many different things have happened, but the bottom line is that he is actually is stellar, and we wouldn't be able to do what we're doing without his support.
So again, we're going to wrap up. We're going to leave, but we want you to join us tomorrow with our yes. hosts, Gerald Jones, Rahim Islam, Mark Wade, Martha Love, Garland G. Smith, Willie Hines, June Perry, Troy Reese, Melissa Goins, Quabenon Nixon, James Phelps. This is just the list that was available during when we went to print. The list has grown of our hosts and sponsors. Join us tomorrow for the Our Power, Our Future Milwaukee Conduit launch, November 17th, 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. at Skybox Sports Bar, 2213 North Martin Luther King Drive. Go to our Facebook page, like it. There's an event out there. Go to Raheem's page, Mark's page, my page, WNOV's page. It's everywhere. So we want to thank you. We look forward to seeing you tomorrow. Again, Rahim will be back on the station tomorrow at 11:30 on the forum with the host, Sherwin Hughes, so you can call in and get some more information. And we will be back on Friday, 3 p.m., same place, same station. Thank you for joining us, and we look forward to seeing you tomorrow. You've been listening to Universally Speaking with Rahim Islam on 860 AM WNOV, The Voice.